They're going to jump out of trees. They'll go down the slide head first. They'll make parachutes out of sheets. But one of the most dangerous things kids will do happens while they're sitting perfectly still. Kids who ride in a car without a booster seat are much more likely to suffer serious or fatal injury after a toddler seat and until they're 4'9" booster kids. And don't let them down.
Go to boosterseat.gov. A message from the U.S. Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
WKPW, Kings Park West, Washington, D.C.
Hot pot of coffee!
Well, folks, it's live television. In a situation like this, I know you understand that mistakes happen. To err is to human, but to really foul up requires a computer, and we've had some computer difficulty.
The following is a presentation of Unidentified Entertainment and 22nd Century Radio, Manassas, Fairfax, Washington, D.C.
WKPW, Kings Park West, Washington, D.C.
I can't tell you why the cover
up. You think aliens have visited here?
No question about it. It's not. The evidence is so powerful. And I wish that Seth, who, when he attended my lecture, admitted he hadn't read any of the five large-scale scientific studies.
What do they want, the aliens? Do you think? What do they want?
I got a whole long list. The bottom line is they're here to quarantine us.
Quarantine us?
Hey, we're a primitive society whose major activity is tribal warfare. I worked on fusion propulsion systems. Everybody in the neighborhood is going to know about fusion. That's what makes the stars work. Within a short time, we'll be able to take our brand of friendship, which everybody else calls hostility, out there. Remember, this is a planet that killed 50 million of our own kind.
So you're saying the aliens are afraid that we will take over their technology?
Didn't say that.
This is all speculation right now, guys. Why don't we start talking about the facts?
Okay, that's where we disagree, is on the facts.
Well, disagrees on the facts.
Have you looked at Bloomberg's Special Report 14, the biggest study ever done?
We have government documents basically stating that these things exist. It's like...
Well, so, you guys, have you been to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base?
Of course I have.
So you can go. You've been there, Larry. It's cool.
All kinds of areas you can't get into.
Everyone always talks about...
Yeah.
I had a clearance.
They don't show you an alien, do they?
No. Just that when you... I had security clearance for a while.
Okay. What would you do if you saw one of these things?
Oh, I would be. I would take a picture of it.
Okay, then what?
A good one.
Then what?
Then I would look at the picture carefully.
And then you'd laugh at yourself because no one would believe you.
Let me get a break. We'll be right back.
Okay, you guys.
We'll be right back.
Quite a step.
It's true. No one would believe you.
We'll be right back.
But Stan, you made a point before break that the U.S. Air Force will not let you see everything. I should hope not. I hope the U.S. Air Force has a few things up their
security. I had 14 years under security.
But that doesn't mean that the stuff that you can't see at, for example, the Wright-Patterson Air Force Museum.
Let me get a call in.
Let's get a call.
New Orleans, hello.
Back off, man. I'm a scientist.
Now, back to time and space with your host, Mike Smith.
Point I'm trying to get at here is that it comes as a great surprise to many people to know that what drove me to get involved was the enthusiastic response of my professional colleagues. And I'm not an apologist ufologist. I tell it like it is. So if we can encourage more people to do that and to recognize that there are serious implications here about man's place in the universe. And one of the major reasons I give for governments not wanting to tell us what's going on is because if they did, there'd be a real push for an earthling orientation instead of as an Australian, a Canadian, American, a Peruvian, a Greek, whatever. And I don't know of any government that wants its citizens to owe their allegiance to the planet instead of that individual government. Nationalism's the only game in town. But as a nuclear physicist, very much concerned about the proliferation of nuclear weapons. Is there a better hope for a decent future for my kids and my grandson than an earthling orientation? I don't know of one. So what I'm saying is people have to decide, what's important in life. I'm not saying run around on the street corners and rant and rave, and I advise anybody if you go out and speak, you better have your facts in hand before putting mouth in gear or you're asking for trouble. Because the noisy negativists can sound very sharp. but they don't sound very sharp. I mean, I want to debate at Oxford University Debating Society in England, which was founded back in the 1820s or something. This house believes that intelligent life has visited Earth, intelligent extraterrestrial life has visited Earth. We got 60% of the vote, which is pretty darn good, considering that nobody there knew anything about UFOs beforehand, anyway. So, it isn't easy. But let me give you an example of the kind of data that helped move me in the direction I'm going. I was speaking to a college class, and there were about 100 students in the class. And I don't know for what reason, wanted to get an idea of their perception of the whole UFO thing. So I said, look, I want you to vote on some subjects by raising your hand, but I want you to do it with your eyes closed so you're not influenced by the people around you, because this is touchy stuff. And your instructor and I will count the votes. Okay. About 100 students. 80% thought most people didn't believe in UFOs. But 80% of that group did believe in UFOs. The problem is that our actions depend on our perceptions of how other people believe. So that's what needs to be changed. I don't get a hard time. Well, as soon as, as a matter of fact, when people find out, a lot of people know who I am, even locally here, see my picture, hear me on a program, and what they want to do is tell me they're citing because they know I'm not going to laugh at them.
Exopolitics and ufology, religion and science, time and space. Hosted by Mike Smith.
You're listening to Time and Space on 22nd Century Radio.
And now we're pleased to bring you our feature presentation.
I'm also inclined to pass along a message. I saw Mr. Rob Swiatek today, and he said to say hello to you.
You've known each other quite some time. Good man.
Yeah, I had a good interview with him. They were doing the Mysteries of Space and Sky conference up in Maryland near BWI Airport, and I saw him and his wife today, so they said to say hello.
Thank you.
I find this a little bit amusing because the main reason I wanted to have you on is because of my extensive collection of podcasts and interviews. Naturally, as you of course know, it seems like everybody that does this puts you on their list and tries to interview you. So we felt obligated, of course, to bring you into the loop and have
keep
you
up with the Joneses, eh?
Exactly. That's exactly right. So we figured it was a good start, and of course I'm a big fan of your work, and I've been following you for quite some time, and I have a couple of your books, and I'm very excited to talk to you. It's nice to finally get you on the phone and have the chance to ask you a few questions. So I'll get right to it here.
Okay.
One of the things that very much influenced our show was actually a comment that I had heard you mention in a couple of the interviews, something I refer to as the 80-80 experiment, just in my own closed circles. And this was the idea that you had gotten a group of students together and had them close their eyes, and you had sort of asked them a pair of back-to-back questions on who believes in UFOs and what do you think the rest of the class is going to answer. I was wondering if I could just get you to explain that just very briefly. I do a poor job of it when I try to tell people, so...
Okay, I was at a campus, and I often do classroom visits during the day, and I can't remember which campus it was. I'm getting old. But anyway, I said, I'd like to try something, but I want to get your views on something. There were roughly 80 students there, I think. And I said, I'd like you to respond with your eyes closed, because I don't want you to reflect what your neighbors might think. I want your viewpoint, not influenced by your neighbors.
Sure.
So, and I said, and your professor and I will count the votes and we'll let you know, but so please don't open your eyes so that you can see how other people are voting. Anyway, the first question was, do you think that some UFOs are alien spacecraft? Or no, the first question really wasn't that. It was, do you think most people think
some UFOs or alien spacecraft, or your choices are most, some, none. Words to that effect.
Okay.
It was more fancily worded than that.
Sure.
Because it was a college environment, of course. And then I'll ask what you think. So it turned out that 80% thought most people didn't believe that any UFOs were alien spacecraft.
Sure.
But when I asked the follow-up question, 80% of the kids there did believe that some UFOs are alien spacecraft.
Right.
So it's the influence of, the ridicule, the laughter curtain, as I call it, the fear of ridicule. And it backs up something else that I check on usually at my lectures. At the end of the lecture, which mostly has been flying saucers are real,
right.
Underline and capitalize the R and put an exclamation point at the end. I'm not an apologist, ufologist.
Right, and we are talking about
I'll ask,
saucers.
After I finish everything, I'll say, I get the first question. How many of you believe that you have seen what I would consider to be a flying saucer? I've defined my terms at the beginning of the lecture. And I said, just raise your hand. We didn't let the CIA in. I'll make a little joke, and, we'll see. So the hands go up hesitantly, and I point and count as soon as I see a hand. One, two, three, four. Move across the room, usually left to right for some reason, I suppose, because I'm right-handed. I don't know.
Okay.
Anyway, the hands go up hesitantly at the beginning. By the time I get to the other side of the room, they go up very proudly and loudly, so to speak.
Hmm.
And typically, it's 10% of the people who were there. So if I got 500 people, we're talking 50 sightings.
Okay.
And that's a higher percentage than I've had polio, and we make laws about polio. I once asked that. Just as a check. Okay, but then I ask the next question is, how many of you reported what you saw? 90% of the hands go down.
Really?
Yeah, really. Now, I'll ask a third question, if there's still some hands. I'll say, how many of you were in the military at the time of your sighting? And if there's still some hands, I'll ask, you want to tell us about it? And I get some great responses to that, like, they told me not to say anything. That was in front of 1,350 people in Texas. East Texas State University. I had another guy in, this is an older person, at Indiana University, in the campus in Indianapolis. And all he said was, they took my pictures. Dead silence.
Oh my goodness.
So I said, look, you don't need to stand up. I'm not asking your name, but I'm sure the audience would like to hear the rest of the story. Everybody collapsed, so he remained seated. He took it seriously.
Wow.
And he said, I was flying a 4-engine Air Force plane out over the Pacific, heading toward an island out there, and there was a plane 20 miles ahead of us, and they radioed back, flying saucer headed your way. We had gun cameras. We took pictures. We called the base to which we were going, because film is handled by special intelligence people, not
sure.
by the crew. And we flew there, they took the film, and we were debriefed and told never to say anything. So I've got a lot of stories like that.
I'm sure you
but do. But the point is, you don't get input unless you make it reasonable for the person to offer something. In other words, you're making it safe,
right.
And the audience helps out. A similar sort of thing happened in reverse. At the beginning of the question and answer, we had a packed house at University of Manitoba, and a guy said, there were probably 800 people in a hall for 650. I mean, they were sitting in the aisles and at the back and so forth. And a guy stood up, the first guy, how about asking this audience how they feel polling them, about flying saucers. So I had presented some data from Gallup polls. And I said, well, I don't usually ask my audience to put themselves on the spot. That's my job. He said, well, I don't think anybody would mind. Everybody clapped. So I asked the same kind of question I asked the students, but without asking people to close your eyes, because after all, I'd just given an hour and a half lecture, you know.
Right.
And I would say that 92%, because I could only find 8% who said no, 92% thought some UFOs are alien spacecraft.
92%?
So, yeah, I take it by finding that sure. Only 8%, I didn't count all those votes,
right.
I counted the 8% who didn't think any UFOs were alien spacecraft. So,
right. But
my point is that I've done enough of this kind of thing to recognize that this is an important truth. That is, most people do accept the reality of UFOs, but they don't think most other people do, so they don't want to come forward unless it's safe. And that's further backed up by the fact that I've only had 11 hecklers and over 700 lectures, and two of them were drunk. And, you know, I'm not an apologist ufologist. I come on very, very strong.
Right.
And so I think it's a fair picture, because I'm told if you talk about sports, religion, or politics, which I don't, but I mean, I've been told by other people, if you talk about any of those subjects, you're getting more than 11 out of 700
sure.
Who are hecklers. You know, they'll give you a hard time. So what I'm trying to say here, I'm trying to encourage people to recognize it's okay. And a similar sort of thing, I was on a radio station by phone in Seattle, daytime talk show, and the woman host said something like, how come we don't hear any sightings, about any sightings around here? And I said, well, I'll tell you what, I will guarantee you that if you ask your audience, this is at the early on in the time I was on, if you ask your audience to call in, and say that you won't use their names, I'll bet you'll get lots of calls. Well, I don't think so, she said. I said, well, let's give it a try. And so she asked, and we had a commercial and so forth. And she was flooded with calls. This is a Seattle station. There are even two people who had seen something strange over Philadelphia. Which is a long ways away. You don't expect
yes,
them to be anywhere out there. What I'm getting at is, there's a consistent picture that emerges that is contrary to the nonsense put out by the nasty, noisy negativists, who will tell you nobody believes in this stuff, nobody cares about this stuff, nobody sees this stuff, only kooks and quacks and little old ladies in tennis shoes. And that's hogwash. And I stress that a bit in the chapter on polls in my book, Flying Saucers and Science. I give the results of a number of polls, and, you know, you got to be careful when talking about polls. A lot depends on how the questions are asked, and also whether you leave a middle ground available to people. There was a poll a number of years ago where somebody said only 46% believe. They didn't tell you that the non-believers were 29%, and the rest had no opinion. You can't count them in with the noisy negativists, the no-opinion types. So, also, the polls have shown the greater the education, the more likely to believe
yes,
in
yes, I've heard you say this before. That's a very interesting point.
Yeah, well, it shows up in the polls. But, again, you have to look carefully and be wary of what people say, because they may be giving you misleading or false or just downright wrong information.
Right.
That's true of all aspects of flying saucers.
Yes.
How come they're never seen on radar? There are loads of radar cases out there, you know.
Right.
But you got to look for them.
Right. And your point about the Seattle radio host is very interesting. That was one of the things I spoke to Rob Swiatek about today, was the idea that many people, I think that this kind of thing doesn't go on in their backyard. And the Swiateks are a perfect example of that, because one of the things that motivated me to do this radio show was the fact that I hadn't actually thought about the idea that maybe some of these sightings were occurring in Virginia. And as soon as I asked that question, they started rattling off. This happened in Roanoke, this happened in Virginia Beach, and so on.
Yeah,
you know,
everywhere you go. Look, I've spoken in 50 states, 9 provinces, 16 other countries. I've got a pretty good sampling. These are lectures, so I usually have
sure.
the chance at the end to ask my questions. And the same in classroom visits. You have to provide a safe environment for people to respond.
Right.
you know, you can't be laughing about how but some of you think you've seen these crazy saucers, you know, something like that.
Right.
People don't want ridicule. Who needs it?
Of course. Of course. Well, that leads very well into my next question, which is just after all these years of lecturing and all the interviews and things that you've done, Tim here, that's my co-host, I had him watching a replay of one of your appearances on CNN, which I'll ask you about in just a minute. After all these years, do you get tired of repeating yourself and repeating these same points over and over? I mean, do you find any
not really, no, because I found that people need the education, and where are they going to get it from? Only from guys like me.
Right.
They're not going to get it from the debunkers, the nasty, noisy negativists, the SETI cultists, you know, SETI, silly effort to investigate.
Right.
And the so-called skeptics. And I say so-called because the people in this field who call themselves skeptics aren't skeptics, they're debunkers.
Right.
Dr. Michael Shermer has a degree and a PhD in the history of science. He's never worked as a scientist. He edits, publishes the Skeptic magazine.
Right.
And he had the gall to go on Coast to Coast Radio, which has a huge audience, you know.
Sure.
And this is right after we'd been on Larry King with several other people. 2 weeks later, and I said I'd like to debate him to George Noory, who was also on that program. So it was arranged. And Michael's been on the show before, so it's not like he's in unfriendly territory,
sure.
You know. And he started off. I couldn't have had a better setup if I had planned it myself. He says, you know, the thing about flying saucers, like all these other paranormal subjects, is that there's a residue effect. Just 5% of the cases, whether it's ghosts or UFOs or anything, it can't be explained. It's just because there isn't enough good data. Wow, what an opening. Because it's total balderdash. So I proceeded to show him why. I said, look, the biggest study ever done for the United States Air Force Project Blue Book, Special Report 14, 21.5% of the sightings couldn't be explained, completely separate from the 9.3%, which were insufficient information, and also contrary to the Secretary of the Air Force lying and saying the unknowns were only 3% of the
right,
total.
Right, I remember hearing you make that comment before, sure. And
well,
again,
I wound up, I gave him five other examples, 18% in this study and 30% in that study and so forth. And at the end of the 3 hours, a vote was taken, and I got 80% of the vote. Because he didn't know anything. He hadn't read my, I'd read two of his books and quoted some of the things he said right back at him.
Right.
And he, of course, hadn't read any of mine. And so I try to make people understand. And I don't get tired of doing it. Because I think most people want to know the truth. They don't know where to look. And I haven't had many opportunities to ask questions of people who know something about the subject. But I want them to understand that there is no case to be made against the reality of some, underlined, some flying saucers as alien spacecraft. Most are not. But I think most people, when you explain a little bit, know that the idea isn't, the question isn't, what are UFOs? Are all UFOs alien spacecraft? Of course not. Are all people 7 feet tall? Of course not. But the basketball coach says, all I need is one guy on the team. I don't need them all to be
right.
7 feet tall.
I heard you talk about cancer drugs, actually, in another interview.
Yeah.
You know, you said if only 5% of the cancer drugs worked, so, you know, well, yeah, those would be the 5%.
And that's being generous.
Exactly. Exactly. I heard you talk also once about this debate that you had done, I guess the Oxford Debate Society. I was just curious to ask about the size of some of the crowds. I heard you mention just a minute ago something like 1,300 people at one...
Yeah, East Texas State University.
That's incredible. And how many at the Oxford debate? Was there an audience there for that?
Oh, yeah, there was a big audience. Well, the total audience was someplace between 800 and 1,000, and they only let the voting be done by actual members of the Oxford Debate Union.
Sure.
It's an old organization, and, you know, 1820 or something like that.
Right.
And some of the people wore tuxes. I didn't know anybody was going to be wearing a tux. But and they voted as they left the hall, so they could show their membership and vote. And we got 60% of that audience. The votes, I think, there were a total of 360 or so votes. The rest were people from the campus and area who were interested in the subject, but they couldn't vote on the final say. And it's surprising because I did, on that trip, I did 7 lectures around England at various and sundry facilities, some colleges, some groups, whatever. Anyway, I did 41 interviews, mostly with guys with these BBC radio voices, you know.
Sure.
I'm sure you've heard them.
Oh, yes.
And they knew absolutely nothing about the subject. Two of them started their interviews with, "What's the T stand for in Stanton T. Friedman?" Like, that's important, boy, I'll tell you. It stands for Terry. That's my middle name, and when I was young, everybody called me Terry, just so will know it's the same person, you know. But, this, in other words, despite the ignorance of the media, apparently we did a good enough job, and my co-debater was Harry Harris, who's an attorney, and Peter Brooksmith, who's a noisy negativist and has written a couple of negative books, was the team leader on the other side, and they had some students for light stuff, interesting sidelight. About a month after the debate, Peter called to order copies of several of the sources that I had talked about. A little late, wouldn't
really?
You say?
Yes, maybe.
Don't bother me with the facts, my mind's made up.
Exactly. You know? Maybe the guilt got to him after a while.
I don't know what it was, but it was funny. At least I thought it was
sure.
funny. The arguments were funny, and there really aren't any good arguments against flying saucer reality. There are people who are ignorant of the data. Now, I did do a debate with Seth Shostak on Coast to Coast Radio, and he and I had met. We'd each done 3 lectures on the last Westward Queen Elizabeth II passage from England to New York, kind of a reward arranged through UFO magazine in England.
Oh.
And we attended each other's lectures, and normally in my lectures, I talk about 5 large-scale scientific studies, and I ask after each one, I'm sneaky, how many of you read this? And if I'm lucky, I'll get 1 or 2%, you know, even at a UFO conference. And, of course, funny thing, Seth didn't raise his hand for any of those things.
Right.
And we did this debate. Now, he didn't set me up the way Michael Shermer had.
Right.
But I got 57% of the vote. 33 said he won. And 10% said, I don't know. So the problem, again, was Seth hadn't done his homework. He and the other SETI cultists just insist, without providing any evidence, that there is no evidence for UFOs. That's easy to say, there is no evidence, meaning I'm too damn lazy to look up any evidence there might be.
Right.
And, you know, that's not science. That's pseudoscience. As a matter of fact, my paper at the last MUFON, Mutual UFO Network International Symposium in August, 40th one that they've had, was the pseudoscience of anti-ufology, because the anti-ufology types are guilty of thinking like pseudoscientists.
Right.
Don't look at evidence, don't look at data, make false claims. Standard approach for pseudoscience.
And from your perspective, that must be unbelievably frustrating that you're actually putting this much effort into trying to just point out to people that they haven't done their homework, rather than being able to focus your energy and other people focus their energy on researching it and solving the problem.
Well, yeah, it's going to take a lot of people to do that, and, you know, I don't mind. Frustration is something when you're in a terribly awkward situation or a surprising situation. But what I find is a consistent picture. You know, I've been waiting for the tough questions from somebody who can, in a particular case, throw something at me that, you know, really puts the kibosh on what I've been saying. And I just don't get those.
Right. It just hasn't happened.
Because they haven't done their homework.
Right. Well, I was playing for Tim earlier this evening, as I think I said already, the one of your Larry King interviews, and I know that this has been covered, and actually I even saw that there was another YouTube clip, I suppose, of you commenting about this, but certainly it was startling to me and startling to Tim to see the frustration that started to kind of come through when you're dealing with debating, you know, you've got your background, and they're putting Bill Nye the Science Guy sitting there next to you trying to come up with these absolutely absurd statements that he's making. I don't know how you couldn't get frustrated. That one was
frustrating because, well, two examples. He makes this terribly phony argument. He shows a document which has one line blacked out, the address of the person who wrote it, and there's no cover-up of UFOs. People talk about blacked-out documents, but look, here's one. It's only the name and a person's entitled to privacy and stuff. Fortunately, I had Flying Saucers and Science with me, and I quickly opened it to the page that has one of the CIA UFO documents. The full page, you can read 8 words. Everything else is blacked out. And so I hope I made him look foolish, but it was such a stupid thing for him to say.
Right.
And separately, off the air, I had heard him on another show that he was on with Larry, where he was explaining Roswell away as a skyhook spy balloon.
Yeah.
And I tried to talk to him about it. I said, you know, they weren't even launched at that time, and they're big polyethylene balloons, and nobody has talked about polyethylene balloons in conjunction with Roswell. That's the way it was, he said, and stomped away. What isn't the way it was, damn it? You know, that's frustrating.
That's incredible. Now I want to put the onus, we can talk about Bill Nye, but I'd like to put the onus on Larry King for just a minute. You can say what you want about Larry King, and maybe any other journalist could just be plugged in his place, but where is he? Why isn't he doing his homework? Why aren't his producers doing their homework?
It's the producers that I would blame on it, and I was shocked to find when I've done 3 shows in the last 3 years with them, and I did one way back in the 90s out in Nevada near Area 51, you know, and I hadn't realized that on the first of the more recent 3, they were showing stuff on the air. We didn't have a monitor to look at. I thought they were showing the people who were talking. No, we were talking, and they were showing crummy pictures, phony pictures, wrong stuff.
Right.
And if I had known what they were doing, I certainly would have said something. So I blame it on the producers. And part of it, I'll go back to the 1994 program. It was a 2-hour Turner Broadcasting special, and they had 4 of us on live, Kevin Randall, Stephen Greer, myself, and a guy named Campbell, Glenn Campbell, not the musician, who was a wheel in providing information about Area 51. And they also had comments that they had taped from a whole bunch of people. Now, early in the afternoon, we went live at 5, I asked one of the producers, not the one I had been dealing with in advance, I said, are we going to be taking phone calls? Oh, sure, yeah. I said, well, how do you do that? You know, we're out in the middle of nowhere, Rachel, Nevada.
that's the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, it sure is. And she said, well, the calls will come into Atlanta, and they'll be sent by satellite to that big truck that's way down there, which, of course, the audience won't see. And we'll monitor them very carefully because, of course, most people don't believe in UFOs. And I said, what? Where'd you get that piece of misinformation? And I read her chapter and verse for some of the polls. And here's the point. Their perception that most people didn't believe in UFOs led them to load the people whose comments they had, including Philip Klass and Carl Sagan and a bunch of... that spaceman, what's his name, William Shatner.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's an astronaut, isn't he?
Yeah. Yeah, he flew the USS Enterprise.
Yeah. If Time magazine gets 100 letters about a subject, and it's 80-20 percented out of those, you know, 80 on one side, 20% on the other, they won't publish the 100 letters. They might publish 10, and 8 will be, they'll reflect the same percentage.
Right.
Pretty close. Well, they loaded the commenters by this false perception. And I think the producers, I don't think she told anybody about our conversation, but I think the producers still share with many media people the nonsense that, hey, most people don't believe in this stuff. You got to really be careful on what you, you know, that you have a compensating view, so to speak, an opposing view. So I don't know how to change Larry and his producers. It is, that part is frustrating. And also the fact that you get interrupted and people say, well, why don't you talk about this? I said, you know, when you're on the show, you have no control over anything. Larry's the only one who knows what's going on. Through his ear, he hears commercial in 30 seconds, caller in, you know, 40 seconds, whatever. You don't know what's happening. The only space you get is what you grab.
Right.
And so, you know, that sounds cruddy, but that's the way it is.
Well, no, and you can see that in the interview, the one that I had played earlier, and we're going to play clips of it. It'll actually be earlier in the show from this conversation. But you can see that. You can see the way that all the guests, not just you, but everybody that's in there, is just scrambling and trying to get their, you know, their two or three sentences in when they can. That's been the real pleasure of listening to other podcasts of interviews with you, because in some of them you actually have an opportunity to take your time and explain your points and, you know, actually get your thoughts across on the subject. I wish it happened more often.
I tell people also about my experience with what's his name, who does the late night show. He's not on the air. Nightline.
Oh.
Yeah, what's his name?
Peter Jennings?
No, that's not my mind. That's a whole other matter.
I'm sorry.
Peter Jennings. But the show I was on with Phil Klass, this is back in 1987, when the MUFON conference was in Washington that year, D.C. And I got a last-minute call and go on to talk about the government cover-up. And so I had my blacked-out documents with me, of course, and I'm carrying them as Phil Klass and I are supposed to go in. Now, first they tell us that, now you're going to be sitting next to each other, separated by that table over there, 2 feet in diameter, the round table. You will each have your own camera looking at you. Do not look at each other. You look at your camera, you look at your camera. Now, that's a strange, you're debating somebody and you can't look at them, can't get all the nonverbal communication clues that we always expect to get when we're talking to people. You know, the raised eyebrow,
right.
That kind of thing. And if that wasn't bad enough, I had the blacked out documents with me. Oh, you can't bring anything in with you. Why not? This makes the point. And we're talking about cover-up. This proves there is one. That's not how we do things. You can't do it that way. Well, you argue, but you lose those battles.
Right.
And so we go on, and Phil did cheat one time. He looked at me. I saw that when I saw the replay. My wife taped the show. But the thing is that they asked me how the host was, and I don't know why. I have a block about his name.
Tim, did you come up with that?
Mr. Freeman, this is Tim Kirk. Is it Ted Koppel you're referring to?
Yeah, exactly. It's late. I'm old.
I was up not at all.
Early
I
this
up
morning.
Understandable.
Anyway, people asked me at the MUFON conference, how'd things go last night, Stan? I said, I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? You're on the show. I said, yeah, but I don't know what you saw. There was a camera on him. There was a camera on me. I don't know what you were seeing. There was no monitor there. Oh, well, how was Ted Koppel? Well, I don't know. What do you mean? You did a show. I said, look, I never saw him, not on a monitor, not in person. He could have been in Timbuktu for all I knew. Well, that's how they do the show. That sounds like radio. Yeah, I know. Again, you're denied all the nonverbal communication that it's a part and parcel of everybody's communication with other people when you're talking about something.
Well, let me seize on that then, because the next question I had written down was basically this idea. I don't know if you ever pay any attention to Fox News, and I'm a fan mostly.
Rarely.
Yeah, and it's more because it's entertaining. I try to be smart enough to be able to separate fact from fiction. But there is an interesting an author by the name of Bernie Goldberg who has continued to pound on this idea that the media as a whole has basically had what he calls a slobbering love affair with President Obama. And I'm not trying to get into any politics on this show, but certainly what you're describing seems to be some sort of, you know, collusion almost, like a system has just been built to somehow, you know, make it happen this way and to be able to suppress whatever they feel like suppressing. And you talk about something called the Cosmic Watergate, and I'm wondering if you could expand on that idea and tell us what you think that is.
Yeah, two different questions here. Is there a cosmic Watergate? I like the phrase. I don't know that I made it up first, but I've used it an awful lot. You know, Watergate was the government covering up stuff, political Watergate.
Right.
Things that would be damaging to the reputation of the Republican Party and were, and caused the president to resign and so forth. Now, what we're dealing with here is the government covering up what it knows about flying saucers. And I easily established with the blacked out documents, the whited out documents, the statement from General Carol Bolander that reports which could affect national security are made in accordance with JNAP 146 and Marine Air Force Manual 55-11 and are not part of the Blue Book system, a startling remark indeed. But here's the kicker. There are many bright people who feel that, first of all, and they all agree, I think, if aliens were visiting Earth, that would be a big story. That would be important. Nobody denies that. But secondly, they feel that they're smart people. They keep tabs on what's important in the world. And when I did a show with a guy who had a talk show, brought me in from California to be on it, and he makes a comment, I read the New York Times. This is off camera. There's nothing in there that would lead me to believe that these things are real. And so the syndrome is that if this were real, it would be important. If it were important, I would know about it, and I don't, so it must not be, and I'm not going to waste my time on something that has no importance. It's a circular reasoning.
And self-fulfilling prophecy, almost.
Exactly, exactly. It guarantees I'll never see any evidence because I know there isn't any. You know, and I'd hate to admit that for 60 years I've been misled.
Right.
You know, David Susskind, that was, incidentally, who had a talk show.
Sure.
And so that's a problem I do run across. And I'm not very shy about blowing that out of the water whenever I get the chance. You don't believe the government's covering up? Can you read beneath these black markings on these CIA documents?
Right.
Can you read beneath the whiteout on these NSA documents? People in the field told me, Stan, they're not covering up anymore. They released this, NSA released 160 UFO documents. They said, yeah, but you can only read one line per page. Everything else is whited out. And the reason they whited out is they didn't like, I got this from the NSA. Phil Classic complained that I would go on the air and show these blacked out documents in early version, but not tell people it was sources and methods information that was the reason for it being, you know, covered up. And I said, I do too tell them that, but so here you have these whited out documents. They're not as impressive, of course. Black goes over well.
Right.
But, you know, and people say, no, they're not covering up. And I say, can you read beneath the black or the white? No, of course not. Well, then they are covering it up. And so, isn't it frustrating? Sure, I'd like to know what they're covering up. But it proves that they are covering something up. And that's what's important.
Mr. Friedman, this is Tim Kirk again. I just wanted to ask you, I'm just an average Joe. I was just wondering, why do you think that the government or the Air Force, why do you think that they're covering up and making a point of doing so?
This is Time and Space, hosted by Mike Smith.
I think this place is restricted, Wang, so don't tell me you're Jewish. Okay, fine.
Who does know the truth, in your opinion, or who do you think? And I mean, how far down does it go? Does the president know? You know, is it who do you think is involved with the cover-up?
There are standard rules for how security works. Need to know is the basic concept. You need a security clearance, but that isn't enough. People think if you've got a secret clearance, you're entitled to see all secret materials. No way, Jose. That's not how it works. You need let me give you an example. When I worked on radiation shielding for nuclear airplanes, I noted in the classified abstract literature that the United States Navy was doing work on radiation shielding for nuclear submarines. And, oh, that looks like an interesting report. I could not get it. I had an appropriate clearance, but the Admiral Rickover in charge of nuclear submarines would not give me a need to know for the data. So that's the first thing. Second thing is, you don't keep secrets by telling everybody. The third thing is that politicians, elected representatives, including presidents, only have a finite lifetime, so to speak. For a long time in the U.S., for example, you can't serve more than two terms. So the old saying in Washington is, presidents come and go, intelligence agencies go on forever. And so one suspects that there are a few people in places like the National Security Council, the Central Intelligence Agency, the National Reconnaissance Organization, the National, the NRO, the NSA, the National, Secrets Agency, National Security Agency, NSA really means no such agency, you understand? Now, these guys are big guys. I mean, we're talking budgets in the $10 billion a year or more. Now, you've got a good example, or you used to, I don't know if it's still there, Pine Gap still in Australia, for example, down your way? Pine Gap was a secret CIA facility, an NSA facility, and even the president of Australia, prime minister, sorry, wasn't allowed in there. It's in the middle of nowhere. Of course, you guys, even more so than Canada, have a lot of nowhere to hide things. But it's in the southern hemisphere, and it was a place for retrieving spy satellite packages that would be redirected and caught by airplanes, believe it or not, flying along and putting out their net and catching the package, which is kind of neat anyway. But so it's the intelligence agencies that you expect to know a good deal about what's going on. Now, what you have to understand, for example, if a pilot is in a fighter aircraft and chasing a UFO and he takes gun camera pictures, which you're supposed to do, when he lands, he doesn't take the films at the local drugstore. There's special people who unload those special cameras, the same with the spy satellite stuff. And that goes to intelligence agency people who review it. They don't come back to him and say, hey, Joe, look at these great pictures you got. So what I'm saying is presidents probably know in a very general sort of way. They want plausible deniability, and presidents have press conferences, prime ministers, presidents, whatever. And so the less they know, the easier it is for them to lie. You might say unwittingly. Now, some people would say some presidents act unwittingly all the time anyway, but that's another story. So what I'm trying to say here is your average congressman, senator, member of parliament doesn't know what's going on. The president probably knows enough to keep his mouth shut. But, you know, when you think the black budget has been estimated in the United States that is not under direct congressional control, it's running about $40 billion a year. Hey, when you think of all the paperwork associated with that, you think the president has time to read much of that stuff? Hardly. So you don't tell him everything and then say, oh, but you can't tell anybody else. You say it's better that you don't know. Security, it works. It works everywhere. Pretty much the same procedures. And there are many situations in which the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. And also, that lies are made to protect secrets. The most obvious, for example, when the first atomic bomb was exploded in New Mexico in 1945, July 16th, I think it was, it was a very successful test, and it was observed from over 100 miles away, even though it was 5:30 in the morning. So people saw it, and there were phone calls to sheriff's offices and places like that, and the government put out a cover story. They said, unfortunately, an ammunition dump blew up, but fortunately, nobody was injured. I've seen the newspaper articles. Now, I'm not saying they shouldn't have done that, but I'm just saying it's standard practice, and a good example of that, in 2001, the U.S. held a meeting in the Washington, D.C. area where they had the families of 166 military people who'd been aboard reconnaissance aircraft that had been shot down by the Russians in the late 40s, 50s, early 60s. Some of those crew members were undoubtedly parachuted. These are reconnaissance planes, have big crews, big airplanes, they're not fighter planes. And there wasn't one word in public about what happened to those people until 2001. Now the Russians knew what happened, our government knew what happened, but there wasn't one public discussion. In other words, both groups had a vested interest in shutting up. One, we were violating the law. Two, the Russians didn't want their people to know that we had penetrated their defenses. The idea was to see how quickly the radar came and what frequencies it operated on, stuff like that. And we shot down some Russian planes that were over North America, too, incidentally, without any public discussion. So this illustrates that we have a world in which what you see is not always all there is at all.
Yeah, let's keep going. Bob Lazar.
Again, I'm going on a limb. I think legitimate and very possibly manipulated. I think Lazar is not the quite the fraud that Stanton Friedman often likes to say. And I know I will catch hell from Stanton when this gets back, because I'm saying this in my next book, which will be dealing with Lazar and well as other people. But the fact is that you push someone like George Knapp to the wall on this. George Knapp knows Bob Lazar as well as anybody, interviewed him at great length, and I asked George Knapp, what's your opinion after all these years on Lazar? And Knapp will not say that Lazar is fake. He will say that there are things Lazar has said that he doesn't find credible on a personal basis, but that, frankly, Knapp has found about 10 or 12 people from equally classified areas of Lazar who have essentially corroborated major parts of what Lazar has said. He doesn't want to openly defend Lazar, but when you're the guy who brought Lazar out into the limelight, and you're a professional mainstream journalist, and you're still not willing to attack Lazar, let's admit the volume right there.
So then, what were some of the interesting things, some of the witnesses that you guys had gotten contact with, what were they saying?
Well, yeah, they told a very intriguing story. So for example, we got Jesse Marcel to come out then. We got a fellow named Vern Mulcahy. I don't think he's alive anymore. Another fellow named Chrome Schroeder. A bunch of people who played various roles in the Roswell episode as we knew it back in 1990. And we had all the UFO researchers that were looking at the crashed UFOs. So we had Stan Gordon there, and Kevin Randall, Stan Friedman, of course, and a number of other people. And we just asked them to do an oral history project, and we recorded on video what they had to say, their testimony, and we grilled them, and that's how that went. We got their stories and for posterity, and we later came out with a DVD or a VHS tape, and that's still available if a person wanted to get a copy of that.
You're listening to Time and Space on 22nd Century Radio.
WKPW, Kings Park West, Washington, D.C.